All right. Can we jump into it?
Yep.
All right. 9.
Yes, sir.
Originally known as 9mm.
Yes, sir. 9mm.
9mm.
Yes, sir.
It's 2016. You're somebody who emerged on record in 1994.
Right.
And you've stayed active and creative right along.
Yeah.
And yet, we're talking today because there's news. You've got some new recordings coming out, right?
Yes, sir.
Tell us, please.
Yes, I have an EP out called The Difference right now. They can get that on RCS Music, I believe, or iTunes. And I have a mixtape called No Country for Old Men that came out in about March. And we're preparing to launch the next two projects.
Well, tell us about the new project.
The next project's called HEISENBERG. And I have an album called N-I-N-E. That I'm working on. So I'm really excited about, passionate about those two, because as time goes on, I keep growing and keep understanding more and more, especially with the release of the newest Tribe album just came out. The De La Soul album came out. So it feels good. Hip-hop feels good again.
It feels like it's time for an artist of your vintage.
Right. It's time for, and I was impressed with the approach. Like, our approach keeps changing, you know, because when you're young, you talk about things that you talk about when you're young. Like, the guy who wrote my first two albums didn't watch the news, didn't care about current events, wasn't worldly.
That guy, you mean you?
Yeah, that guy, I don't even know him anymore. Now, all the things I didn't do, I do now. So I need to talk about who I am now as opposed to, you know, who I was then.
Well, you know, it raises a very interesting question, you know, because I'm also not young anymore. I used to be. And as I've gotten older, I've developed an appreciation for folks who get older and stay creative, not least because here in America particularly, the culture is so youth-obsessed. Mm. And I understand it, but, you know, as I'm not a kid anymore, I don't pay as much attention to youth culture, and I pay more attention to work done by and for grown-ups.
Exactly.
You know? And having said all of that, you know, talk a little more about, you know, getting older and staying creative.
Right. I think the main thing you have to do, acceptance is everything. And I think a lot of people, especially my peers in the hip-hop community, they think, you know, like you just said, you know, being young is being cool. You know what I mean? So they want to still appeal to a certain audience because the industry teaches you that. Only in hip-hop music. We're disposable. You know, any other genre of music, you know, appreciation grows with you. Your fans grow with you. The youth pick up on you as you go on.
And, well, you know, it's okay if you're the... It's not true down the line. If you're the Rolling Stones,
if you're good,
boom.
If you're good at it.
Yeah,
you
yeah.
Know, like you said, staying creative. I think, you know, hip-hop is ever-changing. And if, you know, a lot of people say they are hip-hop. Like, I don't... Hip-hop's not something I do. It's something I am. So as hip-hop changes, I change. I change with it. I change my delivery, my flow, because I'm still excited about it. It's you know, it's like painting a picture. You don't want to draw the same picture twice, so I don't want to do any songs or music that I did before that sounds like that. I want to do something else, you know. I want to keep going and keep growing with the culture. But what I've learned is that I have to also express that side of me that's growing as a human being or as a man. Like, I'm not a kid, so I'm not going to talk about things kids talk about.
Mm-hmm.
But that doesn't mean I can't rap as good as a guy. I'm just not going to say the same things he's saying or talk mm-hmm. about. You see what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So that's where the passion comes from. And it's a challenge because it's something you haven't done yet. So you want to keep trying to do things you haven't done. That's the only thing that keeps me going.
Well, you know, it's very much to your credit because I think a lot of artists get trapped in or trapped by their youthful achievements and, you know, they feel hemmed in by the culture. You know, if you're not doing something kind of aimed at young people, then what are you supposed to do and what are you supposed to talk about? So, you know, for you just to grow up and move on, it's very much to your credit. Let me ask you, you know, let's talk about, you know, some of the particular recordings from these two albums that came out this year that, you know, were challenges for you and of which you're particularly proud because they cover new ground you wouldn't have covered when you first started out.
Right.
Tell us.
I have a song, If We Made a Baby. I think that's the one I played for you. You're talking about. Yeah, it was. It's a song about, you know, I was with a young lady. We were together for quite some time.
Starting when? When you were how old?
I think 1996. I think it was 96.
And you were?
We had, my second album had just came out.
And you were how old? Tell us.
Oh, man, can I? I don't even remember.
Yes, you do.
28? All right. I think. So we were together for quite some time, and, you know, she had got pregnant, you know, and
we got pregnant.
Yeah, she did it by herself. No, she got pregnant, and we decided that the time wasn't right, so we didn't have the child. She aborted the child, and you know, as I look at life now, it's like I don't agree with that choice, like I did then. You know, I realized how selfish me and her both were. So. Things like that eat me up inside. I have this outlet now, you know, this hip-hop, the music, the art form is the outlet to create songs or talk about these type of things that have happened in your life. I would have never did it then because it didn't happen. So that was one of the songs that helped me realize that I have to actually use the things that have happened in my life to go, because I'm not part of the cool crowd no more. You know, I don't hang out on the block, and I don't run around with the thugs, and I don't do any of those things. I'm home watching the news or something. So, you know, I'm a different person, so I've learned how to express it. That song was the one that showed me how to really dig deep into places that I usually don't.
Well, you know what, I want to hear some of the lyrics, but also, let me just ask you, you know, not in rhymed form, you know, when you think back about the decision, do you feel... you know, however you personally feel about, you know, abortion, I want to know, do you still support a woman's right to choose it, but you think you're sorry that you and your girl made that choice? Is that sort of what it is?
Yes, yes. I mean, of course, I support women's rights to choose, or anyone's right to choose, and anything that you want to do in this world.
Sure.
I, you know, long past the days of trying to force opinions or force your ways on people, you know what I mean? So I just regret the choice for me.
And do you regret, as you think about it, you know, having conceived in the first place? I mean, do you think, wow, we should have been more careful?
Yeah, I say and, that. And, so, yeah.
Yeah. All right, well, so what's the rhyme?
If we made it, baby, we'd probably be together now. If we made it, baby, forever I would hold it down. If we made it, baby, we would always be around. If we made a baby, we had a chance and we both felt it. Then you had an abortion, you were so selfish. I let you have an abortion, I was so selfish. In other words, we were both selfish. I think about the child that was so helpless. I pray for forgiveness, hoping God help us, cause we ain't really know what we was doing. We thought the gift from him would somehow ruin all the dreams and goals we was pursuing. Felt like we bit off more than we was chewing. But in retrospect, we didn't even have a clue. We should have been cautious if we wasn't ready for a baby.
I said, well, if we would have had this child, maybe it would have changed us. We would have grown as people. And, you know, we wouldn't have been so selfish.
And just say this, are you still friends with this woman now?
Yeah. But I think these things have to come out of you in order for you to realize, you know, what's real. If you hold things inside, it's just not going
to
work.
No, and it, you know, but even so, it's brave of you to tackle the subject. All right, so what else? You know, what are some of the other, you know, notable songs that you've recorded, you know, relatively recently, the ones that are available for folks right now?
Okay.
That you know, you it's almost as if you can stand back from it as if you didn't cut it. You listen to it now and you think to myself, you know, that's pretty good. You think to yourself, it's good.
Oh, Blessed Tonight. And we're shooting a video for it. It's a song called Blessed Tonight.
Right,
I think people are really gonna dig that one.
And what's it about?
About feeling blessed tonight. Because you don't know if tomorrow's coming. So you feel blessed tonight. And you should let everybody know you feel blessed. You know?
I'm feeling blessed tonight, I put the rest aside. I'm feeling blessed tonight, for whoever bugging, I got the pesticide. Cause I'm feeling blessed tonight. Painting a picture with it makes it so vivid, gives it a glossy feel. See it so vivid, is it a dream or such a surreal scene? I live it, I love it, I float right above it. This new piece I discovered, and if I had to do over, I would keep it the same. Cause I wouldn't know love if I ain't feel that pain. If I ain't feel that rain on the side of my face, then I wouldn't know sunshine when it takes its place. I bathe in his grace, I feel the touch of the Lord. Before the train leave the station, I'm all aboard. Cause the devil is waiting to pick me up in the cab, he right there. I told him I ain't paying the fare, ain't no taking me there where I don't wanna go.
Just come into the moment, understand what's going on.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it's so simple. It's just you're sitting there and you're thinking to yourself and go, you know what? You know, I feel blessed tonight.
You know what? it's simple, but it's huge. And I think, you know, mostly folks don't do it. And I'll tell you about my old friend, the Reverend Run. Now he's known as the Reverend Run. But there was a period, you know, after he was DJ Run, and he went out on his own and he began to send out a little e-blast every day called the Rev Run's Words of Wisdom.
Yep.
Yeah.
I followed him.
So that was maybe 2004, and he did it for, you know, for years. And every day it would just be a little spritz, right? And sometimes he'd come up with something new, and sometimes he'd come back to old favorites. And one of the things that he came out with over and over again that had an impact on me was count your blessings. Mm-hmm. I'm not a religious person, but, you know, just that admonition, that advice, you know, look around you and figure out what you got going on and you know, why life is good.
And that's exactly what I did. I was sitting around and I just thought to myself, like, I really am blessed to A, still be able to do what I love to do, B, still have all my faculties,
right?
You know, be healthy, still be able to make a living. You know, these are things that people take for granted.
Right.
You know, until you visit a cancer ward. And then you realize that your little problem, your iPhone, you lost it today. So what?
Yeah.
Your car's broke. So what?
Right. Exactly,
you know,
right.
You got your health. And, you know, I'm not super religious myself, but I believe good fortune is a blessing in a world where anything could change in a moment. Each day that you make it past, every 24 hours is a blessing.
Yeah, that's a good thing. Mm-hmm. I want to talk, you know, we'll talk in a minute maybe about these new recordings that you've got coming. But, you know, one of the things that was interesting to me was, you know, learning that, you know, you made rap records and rap albums for Profile Records, 94, 95, 96, 97, I think.
Yes.
And then, you know, now it's almost 20 years since the last of those came out. And one of the things that you've done is you've been a guest artist on a bunch of records for other artists.
Yes.
Many of whom are rapping in foreign languages.
Overseas, yes.
Talk about that.
That's been actually a lot of fun, because it actually showed me just how far this hip hop culture has gone to. When I started getting requests from Poland, the Netherlands, you know, Ireland. I think I've done about 30 records with people from all over the world. And, you know, they'll send me a copy after it's done, because now you don't have to even meet anyone with technology. You know, they send me the track and I'll send them the vocals back, and then they'll put the song together later, you know, and they'll send it to me and I'll get to hear it and be like, sometimes I don't even know if they you know, they weren't gonna rap in English. Cause they'll just tell me the subject of the song and I'll hear them on it and go, wow, you know what I mean? This really, perfect example. There's a guy named Haki Bela from Turkey. And I did this.
Say it again, Haki Bela?
Haki Bela, Haki Bela.
How do you spell it?
I think it's H-A-K-I, B-E-L-L-A.
Okay.
I think it's something, yeah, I think so. Well, anyway, this guy reached out to me a long time ago. He's one of the first people. I sent him the verse. He contacted me a year later when he had the song completed. And he said he was sending a friend of his that was coming to America, could I do some video footage for him? So I'm like, okay, this is a little much for what you paid me. But then he explained to me how he was able to buy his mother a house in Turkey because of the song that I did with him. So when that happened and he was so gracious and so, you know, thankful, and I realized that, you know, me doing that for him was even bigger than the money that he paid me, or bigger than whether or not the record was a hit record or something, but to reach across, you know, a planet and touch somebody else's life and help. I mean, the karma, it feels good. You know, I think karma is something you feel immediately. You feel bad karma when it follows you, but the good karma hits you immediately.
Sure.
So it made me take those features a lot more serious, and I started really putting effort into giving these guys quality verses. And I think that helped me get a lot of work overseas with a lot of these different artists. Germany, I just did a song with the Snow Goons. Their producers in
That's
Germany.
A hilarious thing, the Snow Goons.
Their producers in Germany are very big, and it's me, Sticky Fingers, okay. Roscoe's, Drez, OC, I believe, is on the record, Psycho Less. So, you know.
It's and any German language rappers?
No, these guys, they got all American rappers, but they're German producers that are okay. very popular. So I just did some work with them, which I'm excited about because they have a really huge following. And, you know, and I have an album out called Quanine, the Overseas Shipment, that came out in Germany. In 2009.
How'd it do?
It did pretty good.
Hockey Bella. Yeah. Hockey Bella. 9mm. Yeah. You know what it is, man. Woo. It's my prerogative. My prerogative, baby. If life is a bitch, then death is its mistress. You better not cheat. You reap what you sow. I creep through the snow like Eskimos. I flip holes in foes like donuts. Hold up, from BX to Germany. Motherfuckers heard of me, they know how I get down. Nickname emergency. Put that metal up in you like surgery. Till every last one of these niggas wanna murder me, then nerve me. They come with this attitude, even though most of these rappers is pussy. I ain't mad at you, I had a few pills with Bella.
What up?
Now I'm ready to rock your ass to sleep like a good fella. You will die a cappella. No music playing, just the sound of gunshots, AK spraying. Blah, blah. That's the last thing you hear, then everything stops. I don't know what happens after that, but I know it ain't no coming back. Nah, it ain't a secret. Big Nod is coming back. Yeah, my prerogative. Hayat çok zor. Her zor. Veriyoruz bir aşağı cümlesi. Peşimizi kulakmayan ölmek arkamızda. İnsanlar saklanıyor gizli oralarda. Yüceksin ki keşmak burada. Sana geliyor şu anda. Esrar engin sırları olan kalabela. Hayat fani, ölüm ani. Bu dünyanın her tarafında.
Just, I love what he loves about it, which is it's evidence of hip-hop having gone global. You know, that's big. You know, I want to hear people rapping, you know, in Turkish, and then he raps in English. And it's flavor. It's hip-hop. It's not the usual flavor.
The beats that these guys choose and use are so hip-hop. They don't care about radio, none of that shit. You know what I mean? They come up with that authentic sound. They really are into it.
Well, but also, you know, I mean, one of the things I like is that, you know, they're always going to, not always, but oftentimes, they're going to take advantage of, you know, local traditions, local beats, local instrumentation,
right.
All of that kind of stuff, because, yo, they're not in New York.
Mm-hmm.
And the best of them aren't going to pretend to be in New York. Influenced by New York? Yes. Do they want Nine rapping on the record? They do. And even so, it's not going to sound like something that was made here always.
Ain't a rapper hard as me, pardon me, excuse me. Game try to abuse me, use me. Steal my float and get low, well guess what? Here come a chest shot, head shot, leg shot, forget me not. Remember, I will injure any one of you pretenders from December to December. Yeah, remember, I will injure any one of you pretenders from December to December. Ihr könnt es drehen oder wenden, wie ihr wollt, ihr kleinen Fische seid immer noch nix wert. Und egal wer da kommt, los raus, keine Furcht, ihr feuert einen Schuss, doch wir bringen mehr. Mein Gefühl, wollen übernehmen, doch ich greif wieder zu den Waffen. Dein Style ist ausgelutscht und dein DJ kann nicht cutten. Meine Rhymes klappen wie Kartentricks aus der Hand heraus. Der rappende Cyborg, mein linker Arm ist ne Panzerfaust.
You know, one of the great early gods of hip-hop, DJ Hollywood, you know, made his career here. Honed his skills here, and lived in Europe, I think in France, for years, and continued to, you know, ply his trade there. Was there ever a time, has there been a time when you thought, you know what, there's more money for me, there's more of an audience for me in Europe, and maybe I should move?
No, I never thought about moving, and thank God, I will be going there next year. We will be touring, I can't wait.